Good morning, children, and welcome back to our online classes. Today, in our English class, we are going to learn the story, The Diamond Maker. The story, The Diamond Maker, has been written by H.G. Wells. So let's learn something more about the author's life. Herbert George Wells was an English writer, prolific in many genres. He wrote dozens of novels, short stories, and works of social commentary, history, satire, biography, and autobiography. His work also included two books on recreational war games. He was born on 21st September 1866 in Bromley High Street, London, United Kingdom. He died on 13th August 1946 in the Regent's Park, London, United Kingdom. His movies include Things to Come, The Time Machine, War of the Worlds. And his short stories include The Red Room, The Country of the Blind, and The Star. So this story, The Diamond Maker, which has been written by H.G. Wells, who was born in 1866 and died in 1946, was first published in the Pall Mall Budget in 1894, and it was reprinted in the Stolen Bacillus and Other Incidents in 1895 and The Door in the Wall and Other Stories in 1911. So the story begins something like this. The story is told by a businessman, a rich man, who, after a long and tiring day, decides to stroll down to the embankment in London and relax by watching the River Thames flowing by. So many of us, whenever we are tired or whenever we are in a tension or we are worried, we all feel like sitting quietly, going to a place where we can just enjoy the nature, where we are quiet, where we get some peace of mind. So perhaps this rich businessman also wanted some peace, so he decided to walk to the river to the embankment and watch the River Thames flowing by. And suddenly, when he was doing this, he heard somebody speak to him next to him. The narrator is approached by a ragged and disheveled man who looked as though he had been kept in a dustbin for a week. He looked very shabby. After a few moments of conversation, the man tells the narrator that he is able to make diamonds and produces a brown pebble almost as big as the top of his thumb, which he asks the narrator to examine. So by looking at the stranger's appearance, the narrator felt that he must be a poor man, but it was very unbelievable that this man made diamonds. This strange man had diamonds, he owned diamonds and he made diamonds. Okay, that was very unbelievable just looking at the appearance. So we always say, don't judge a book by its cover. We say that appearances are deceptive. It is very true in this context. Now, it cannot be, when he handed over the pebble, that is the brown pebble which he called as a diamond, to the narrator, he scratched it with a penknife to examine whether it was truly diamond, and which easily makes a score mark on the narrator's watch glass. So this knife, which easily made a mark on the watch glass, was not able to make a mark on the diamond. Therefore, he came to a conclusion that it could really be a diamond. The man offers to sell the pebble for $100, which makes the narrator a little hesitant, as real diamond that size would be worth many thousands of pounds. So when the man said that he would sell the diamond for $100, then the narrator had a bit of confusion and could not trust the diamond maker, could not trust the strange man. He felt perhaps this diamond was stolen from somewhere. Therefore, he is selling it for such a small amount. He did not actually believe that if it was truly a diamond of that big size, it was worth some thousands of pounds, and it was being sold in very small amount. So that made him not trust the stranger. When the narrator asked the man how he came by such a diamond, he repeats his claim that he had made it. So the narrator was of the opinion that perhaps the man had stolen this diamond from somewhere, but the stranger clarifies him that this is my diamond and I have made it. The man tells the narrator that for 15 years he has worked alone and in secret so that others could not copy his work, allowing him to sell his diamonds without it being known that they could be produced in large quantities. So as he wanted to hide that process of making diamonds, therefore he wanted to keep it as a secret, he was not able to sell the diamonds for the past 15 years. Though he worked day and night to make diamonds, but he was not able to sell them because anyone who would take them would ask him how he had made diamonds, and he did not want to share that secret. So he, though could make diamond in very large quantities, but he was not able to earn money from these diamonds. He could have become richer, but he could not earn money, enough money even to fill his stomach, because of keeping this as a secret. And I have no university degree. I don't have much education except in chemistry. This is what he tells the narrator. And I found I was spending a lot of my time and energy for very little money. So in order to prepare the diamonds, he had to work somewhere. Okay, and earn money as a teacher, as a newspaper boy. So he had to make some money to get the apparatus needed for making the diamonds, and also to keep himself stomach full. So therefore, though he was not very educated, but he had knowledge of chemistry and he knew how diamonds could be made. And it was important that if I really meant to make a pile, people should not know it was an artificial process. So people should feel that this diamond I have got naturally. They should not know that it is an artificial diamond and it could be made. So in this process of keeping it as a secret, for all these years I could not sell the diamond. One could make diamonds by the ton. So I had to work all alone. At first I had a little laboratory, but as my money began to run out, he had to give up that laboratory also, and he had to start making it in his house itself. After his money ran out, he continues his experiments in cheap lodgings in Kentish town and took various menial jobs to support himself, small jobs. He finally succeeded when, using an idea suggested by the experiments of Gabriel Auguste Dobry. So Gabriel Auguste Dobry was a French geologist who was known for his dangerous experiments on the artificial production of minerals and rocks. So following his experiments, he put the mixture which might produce diamonds together with dynamite in a cylinder too strong to burst when the dynamite exploded. So he now through these experiments tried to make artificial diamonds. So he is explaining us how he had made these diamonds. For 2 years he kept the cylinder hot in the fire in his room to give the diamonds time to grow so that he could make big diamonds. However, as he inspected the results, his neighbor, suspecting that he was a bomb-making anarchist — anarchist is a rebel, a person who goes against the law — told him he had called the police. The man was thus forced to abandon the lodging house, leaving him in the state in which the narrator has found him. So he was all ragged, he was all in a poor state, because now he had no shelter, no food. He had to live in the fear of the police. Homeless and carrying diamonds worth hundreds of thousands of pounds, which he cannot sell without causing suspicion. So when he tried to sell the diamonds, people started suspecting him as a thief. Therefore, he wanted to sell the diamonds to somebody who would trust him that he is not a thief and he is a diamond maker. An anarchist is a rebel, a person who secretly works against the government and the law of the land. The narrator is more than half convinced by the man's story because, okay, the man was telling him exactly the process of diamond making. So this made him feel that maybe the narrator knew how to prepare the diamonds. Okay, so he was convinced to an extent. Okay, but not having 100 pounds on his person to buy the pebble, invites the man to visit his office the following day. But he refuses, suspecting a trap, although he does accept the narrator's business card. So when the narrator gave him the business card, he felt, to some extent he believed it. But then he suspected him that maybe the stranger was trapping him. So whether giving him £100 is worth enough for the diamond, or should he drop the idea completely? So this was a suspicion that he had, but to some extent he was also convinced that this is a real diamond, and he also felt that this, if he is not taking this diamond from the stranger, then maybe he is losing a worthy deal. So he had the dilemma, should I trust him or shouldn't I trust him? And the businessman moves from that place and he tells him that in the following days, if you ever feel like meeting me, so you should come to a place where I would call you. Come to a place where I would call you and you can then have a deal with me and pay me the amount. So twice he tries to meet the narrator, but in vain, he is not able to meet him. The businessman never sees the diamond maker again, although on one occasion he does call while the office is unattended. The story ends with the narrator reflecting on the encounter, wondering if the man is dead or will perhaps re-emerge and become famous, and if he himself missed a business opportunity. So the man once comes to his office and he is unattended there, and the story ends when the narrator feels that he has lost a business opportunity. He could have bought such a big diamond very cheaply, and he also felt that he also started thinking about the stranger. He started thinking that what might have happened? Did the stranger die without food, or suddenly he was able to sell it to somebody and re-emerge as a famous personality? So that is what he felt. Okay, so finally it was that the strangers were just moved unknown. This is what he understood. So the ending, the climax of the story keeps a pause, leaving us to imagine what must have happened with the diamond maker. Okay, so let's understand something about these artificial diamonds. It has been known since the experiments of the French scientist Antoine Lavoisier in 1772 that diamond is a crystalline form of carbon. James Ballantyne Henney in 1878 and Ferdinand Frederick Henry Moissan in 1893 both claimed to have made artificial diamonds. Moissan's method was to heat charcoal, which is also a form of carbon, and iron in a furnace. But the diamonds produced were exceedingly small. It was not until the 1950s that the production of artificial diamonds became commercially viable. So this is how the artificial diamonds have come into the production, after many experiments. So in this story, the half deranged diamond maker represents a familiar theme in Wells' stories. His conviction is that science has unlimited possibilities. That is how he was able to make the artificial diamonds, for both good and evil. And that knowledge without moral responsibility corrupts and ultimately destroys its possessor. So as if he would have had a little bit of moral responsibility, then the stranger, the diamond maker, would not have died such a pitiful death, or maybe he would have become famous and he would have earned some money and would have been in a better position. Just imagine a person having diamonds in his pocket and without food, he lies on the road with all the diamonds out of his pocket. Just imagine the situation. So all this is because you become more and more selfish. So use the science for good of the society, which makes you famous. Otherwise, it ultimately destroys its possessor. This is the, I felt that this is the theme of the story, which Wells wanted to convey us. Clear, children? The words that we have come across in this story is are the embankment, a street along the north bank of the River Thames in central London; parapet, a railing along the edge of a bridge; sophisticated, stylish, refined and complex looking; wretched, here in this story it means tattered or worn out; mineralogy, the study of minerals; corundum, a naturally occurring transparent material; clux, a chemical mixture; costermonger, a person who sells fruit or vegetables from a cart or street stand. So these are the words that we have come across in this chapter. I would like you all to learn the meanings and try to make the sentences on your own. Okay, children, so the homework for you after you watch this video is complete all the exercises given in the textbook and try writing the answers yourself. Attempt the answers in your own words. Thank you, children, and have a good time.